Welcome to Face to Face. Today we're joined by prominent Bahraini human rights activist Nabeel Rajab. Now, known for his fierce criticism of the government, Nabeel has often found himself being targeted by the regime. Nabeel, thank you for joining us. Tell me, why does the regime view you as such a threat?
Because I do create awareness. And for them, education and awareness is the most dangerous thing they see. That's why they marginalize people in an education. They don't give people in a fair manner scholarship to study abroad. Scholarship are going to those newly naturalized people, but not to the indigenous people. Education, awareness is very dangerous. I'm one of the guys who created the human rights movement in this country. I'm one of the guys who've been advocating at the local, grassroots level, international, regional level on human rights. And I'm trying to bring awareness as fast as possible, as much as I can, empower people in learning what justice is all about, what freedom is all about, what liberty is all about, what democracy is, how to fight for democracy, how to struggle peacefully. So I am one of the guy whom they cannot say he's a terrorist, although they're trying, because they labeled all the opposition and human rights defender as a terrorist. They can't label me as a terrorist. And I've been speaking. I've been speaking everywhere. I've been writing. My account and all Twitter and social media are very popular. People listen to me. So they see that as a threat. Either you are on their side or you are in their enemy. They look at you that way. Either you say, agree with whatever we said, or you are an enemy. And that's why I'm considered to be an enemy. And that's why I spend most of my 5 years, if it is not in jail, banned from travel, punishing me. That's beside what happened to my family, attack, fighting us economically, socially, at all level. Me, my children at school, my wife at work. And this is a struggle we're going to take. We're going to continue. And I know a lot of nations have fought for freedom, and they paid the cost. And we are paying cost of the struggle, of the values that we are fighting for. They're going to remain seeing us, a human rights community, as enemies. Yes, we are, because we're bringing awareness. We're bringing awareness of human rights, justice, liberties, freedom, advocating for struggle, for peaceful struggle for democracy, not to surrender, to continue fight for democracy and freedom. And we will not stop. And they know, they're confident that we will not stop. How much it's going to cost us, we will not stop.
Let's talk about your time in detention. Were you ever subjected to any torture?
I feel ashamed to speak about how they torture me, because it's very minor with comparing to the others. And I don't want to be a symbol of, because there are bad people were tortured bad. People were tortured to death in this part of the country. But what they've done to me, mainly psychologically, they have troubled me a lot. They want to damage my brain. They want to damage my thinking. They want to damage my personality, because they isolated me for 2 years. For 2 years, although everybody in jail together here, I'm the only one who were kept in isolation for 2 years. And isolation, but then they brought people with me. But what type of people they brought? They brought with me some Asian people who were charged with prostitution. So they kept me with many prostitutes for 2 years. I was not able to talk in human rights. I was not allowed to talk in human rights on the telephone with my family. I was not allowed to talk about anything by telephone except, hi, hello, how are you, fine, thank you, that's it. So in 2 years, a man who been with people in the street, you isolate him completely from his community, and you put him with many prostitutes in 2 years. It was a difficult thing, and I don't know. I mean, I know why they did that, because they think that I'm influential and I could influence the people inside jail and I could teach them. And I've been teaching, even with those men who were, I've been always spending my time teaching them languages, teaching them human rights, teaching them anything. So they did isolate. That's the most dangerous and the most torturing method being used with me. When you isolate me, my mom died. By law, they should release me for 3 days, daytime only, to attend her funeral. And I was not granted that right. And then I have a lot of people in my family, like two uncles, and one uncle and two aunties and cousins, who passed away along with my mom, and I was not able to. So this is a difficult moment that I passed, but I am strong, thanks God. And I believe in the message that I have, and that's why it made me strong. Beside the solidarity of the international community, my friend around the world, who I've been working in many countries many years ago, in different countries, fact-finding mission, heading teams of investigation. So that has created me a lot of friends around the world. So when I was in jail, those people stood with me and they raised my name everywhere, every conference, along with the human rights community in France, Bahrain Center for Human Rights, and other group who were fighting day and night. So listening to those stories, how much people were standing with me, that made me continue and made me strong.
How is the situation in Bahrain today compared to how it was in 2011?
In 2011, you will see one protest where 200,000 people taking part of it. Logistically, practically, you can't do that now because police will fire tear gas, rubber bullet, and shotguns, and they'll kill people. And we have tens of people who were killed. We have thousands and tens of thousands of people who were injured. So you can't do that. You can't come out in the street because a protest is banned. Not anymore. It does not exist in this country. So you see, instead of one protest, 200,000 or 100,000, you see hundreds of protests on a nightly basis. Each of it, tens of or hundreds of people taking part of it, and where it end up with the clashes with the police. So we have protests. It's not as much as before, yes, because the repression is so bad now. Not as much as before because 90% of activists are behind bar and the left are left in exile. And maybe very few, maybe I'm one of very few people who remain outside jail and who spent last more than 2 years in jail. But majority are in jail, so you have to take that into consideration, not as strong as before. Violence used by government, repression, people were targeted in their life, in their living, in their economy, in their school, in their work, in their jobs. Shia being targeted everywhere. So it's not as much, but it does continue. It's not a stable country. It's not a peaceful country anymore. And you can see the indication of that in our economy, which has been declining day by day, day by day. Things is going from bad to worse. That's an indication the political situation is not stable. If there is no a political solution, there will not be stability in this country.
How is the political opposition treated here?
Well, as you see, political opposition is like nothing. They can't do nothing. They can't even have a meeting of their member, like what you see Al-Wufaq. They can't have a peaceful protest. They can't even boycott the election because they've been targeted and their people, grassroots people, they've been targeted. So there is no room for opposition. They're really struggling hard. Half of the opposition now leader are in jail, as you know, and many of them are out of the country. The few leaders who exist, they living in very difficult environment. There is no room for people to criticize the government. The government is not tolerant about criticism. So the situation for a human rights community and opposition community is very difficult. It's not there. That's why all the human rights activists are either in jail or in exile.
Now, we know the police has been cracking down on the protesters, but is this only the case for the Shia citizens, or does this also happen to the Sunni population?
Well, there is no crackdown on the Sunni population to compare that, but except in the 70s when the opposition were jointly leftist Shias and Sunnis, yes, they were cracked down against all of them. But now, a great majority of the protesters are Shia. Why they are Shia? Because they are the marginalized group. They are the target of government discrimination and repression. So that's why they are ahead of any movement or revolution. At the elite level, you have Shias and Sunnis, but at the grassroots level, you have only Shias. And unfortunately, you have a policing system exist from mainly naturalized people. and almost all of them are from Sunni community. So you see police attacking protesters. It looks like Sunni attacking Shia. Although the sectarian dimension or the sectarian reason is not there, but this is the way government have built the opposition and built the government institution. Government institution being dominated by a Sunni sect, marginalized people, victims are from Shia sect. You go to the judiciary, you see court judges from a Sunni community, you see people be brought before court for taking part in a peaceful protest, Shias. And at the same time, where the jail where I was, thousands of political prisoners, Shia, then you see hundreds of naturalized Sunni brought from outside to control that jail. And that apply on our army also, that apply in most of the institution. So the government divided the country into a powerful, a loyalist Sunni and a weak majority Shia, marginalized and living as a second or third class citizen. But I have to clarify and make one thing very clear. We don't look at it from a sectarian angle, and we don't want to look at it in the sectarian angle, and we don't want people to take it that angle. Because we have a political problem with the government. We have a political dispute with the government. Government made it that way so that we have, instead of fighting with the government, we go fight with the Sunni. But it's very clear, we fight with the government. They formed this system that made Shias and Sunni separated. They build that system which make Shia living in area and Sunni living in area. And Bahrain government built an apartheid system. Apartheid means separating Shias and Sunni. Almost half of the country Shia cannot go and stay and live. There is no boundary as we have in Israel or as we did have in South Africa. But by practice we have. You can't buy a house in some area where government don't want Shia to stay. You can't build a mosque in majority of the country for Shia. In fact, they have demolished a lot of mosques. So what our regime is trying to present the case as it's a Shia Sunni, and they put all their forces behind presenting it that way, pushing it to be that way. But it's very clear to us not to get dragged into a sectarian conflict. We have a problem about human rights, about justice, about equality, about freedom for a nation who've been struggling, ruled by a dictatorship, ruled by a repressive royal family. Our problem is with them, about rights, right-based revolution, got nothing to do with religion. So we don't want to get into that, and we're trying to make our nation aware of that. And I think the people on the opposition side who believes in the struggle are aware. They are not getting dragged. Although we have a lot of attacked, sectarian attack against businessmen, against Shia, but there was no reaction, and we will not react into. We know what we want, we know who is taking our rights, and from where we ask, from where to fight for our rights, not with people, with the people who build up that system.
Now, from what I've seen in the few days I've spent in Bahrain, the surveillance in Shia villages has been pretty high. So what is life like for those living in the villages on a day-to-day basis?
Well, on a daily basis, the villages have been surrounded by police who've been brought from Pakistan and Jordan, Yemen and Syria. And on a daily basis, houses, tens of houses, in a daily basis being attacked. Money being stolen, valuable item being stolen by those police institution and police personnel who been brought from outside the country. And it is very ugly thing when you see your country, your nation are suppressed by people who were brought from outside. Your regime, the regime ruling here, brought people from outside the country. Jordan, you have Syrian fighting us, Pakistanis fighting us, Baluchis fighting us, Yemeni fighting us. And now we have British, I don't know how much they're going to be involved in their arms. And then when we speak, they say, oh, you are from outside. You've been supported from outside. They have brought the whole world to fight us. And they're accusing us of people depending on the outsider. So you have a police which been told that you can do anything, because many people were killed. People were not brought before justice. People were not jailed or punished for killing protesters or for torturing. Thousands of people were tortured. Many people were tortured to death. We have tens of thousand people in this tiny, small nation of 600,000 Bahraini. We have tens of thousand people injured since 2011. We have thousands of people living and the pellets in their bodies from the shotgun, and they can't even go to remove it. They're afraid government will. Thousands of people. We have tens of people who lost their eyes because they were shot in the eyes. And we treated them at home, because if they go to hospital, they're going to be arrested. So you are in that situation. Every few meters, 100 meters, the roadblock will stop you, and checkpoint where police from Yemen or Syria or Pakistan will check your thing, humiliate you, insult you. If they know you are a Shia, then you continue. This is the way we have been living in the past years.
Now, you've just spoken about police brutality, and from what we know, a number of British figures were hired to come in and overhaul the Bahraini police. So have you seen any significant changes as a result of that?
Well, if they train them, they should have taught them. Police have to represent the nation. Now, they're training the police the same way they were training police in Northern Ireland, which used to be made of one part of the religion, of one part of the society. You can't empower that police institution unless you repair the structure of it and the way it's been made. Our police made me in a sectarian basis, made of one sect attacking another sect on a daily basis. That's the main problem. If you don't solve that problem, you can't. It's not about the training, how to speak and how to say that. It's not about training. It's about Bahraini government bringing mercenaries from outside. They're calling them police. According to the international law, they're mercenaries. They're bringing them to suppress their nation, to be using them for the crackdown against the struggle of people fighting for democracy. This is itself is against the international law, against the humanity. They're training those kind of police. This police has to be finished and made again. Made from people of the Bahraini people, Shias and Sunni together. Not Sunnis fighting Shias. Not army made of a Sunni, not a police should be made of Shias and Sunni. So that training is useless, because the body is useless. The body is corrupt. You can't train a body, it's corrupt, when the foundation has a problem.
Now, despite reports of ongoing human rights abuses and torture, the West has remained silent. And not only has it remained silent, but they've also continued to strengthen their relationship with the regime. Why do you think that's been the case?
It's not something new. Hypocrisy of foreign policies of many European countries is not something new. And Western government, specifically I speak about UK, speak two languages. One about human rights, justice for inside, but when it comes to outside, it's interest. Priority are their interests. Many time in many area, interests have a conflict with the values and moral values and human rights. So they choose to go with their interest and against those value they being talking about inside their country. And this is what happened in Bahrain. In Bahrain, they think their interest lies with the royal family, as it is, with the repressive regime, as it is. And they maybe think now Shia are a threat, because Iran is not online with the Western government, Hezbollah fighting Israel. So if we give room to the Shia in democratic process to have room in the political arena, that might strengthen Hezbollah and Iran. This is something which you never hear about. It's never been said. That's why they have a common interest now, the Gulf countries and the UK government. all of them, they don't want to empower the people of Bahrain, because people of Bahrain are majority Shia. Those, they don't want to do that because they want to continue running the state as they did in the past 200 years. Wealth, power, all in their hand. UK government want to continue their business, want to have more business. And as far as they stayed with Bahrain government, they're going to get more business from Saudis, from Emirates, from Bahrain. And at the same time, there is something. They have fears from Shia. They're afraid of Shia. I can't help it. I born a Shia. And my oppressed nation are Shia. We didn't choose to be a Shia, but we are Shia. We born to be a Shia, an oppressed nation, and we have obligation to fight. Now the Western government, UK government, will stand with our struggle for democracy, or that's going to be a black spot in their history. And we think that whoever stays with the repressive regime, they have to pay the cost. They have to know this is going to damage their reputation. And we're going to go behind them. And every legal, legitimate means, we're going to go behind them. Even the UK government, UK people who stood with the repressive regime for money and for business and interest, who supported the dictators against the legitimate demand of people for democracy, human rights, and justice. It is a hypocritical foreign policy that my nation are paying the price of it. This business that they have with our government is stained with the blood of our children. And we should not let it go easily. We should be behind them. We should shame them. In every level, regional and international, and all government, non-government institutions, UN, EU, and everywhere. UK government is playing a very negative role. UK government against our struggle for democracy and human rights. UK government is against our human rights. And we will not let that happen. We will not let that go free of charge. It's going to cost them on their repetition. And we're going to make sure that does cost them in their repetition.
Do you think we'll ever see change in Bahrain anytime soon?
This is not important for me very much as I see people fighting for the change. Our duty and obligation to continue fighting. We are believers in God. That comes from God, we said. Now, religiously or not, this is how we see it. We have to provide all our strength and effort and activism and struggle for that change. Now the change comes in my time or comes in my son's time. The defeat when I decide to stop, the defeat when my people start to stop and surrender, the victory when we are in the street and continue our struggle, and we are in the street, and we are continuing our struggle. So will I'm going to see the change or not, never comes in my mind. Never important to me, as much as we have to keep fighting for the change. If it comes, we say, thanks God. If it doesn't come, we're going to continue fighting. So that should not be an obstacle. Because if you put that always in mind, and if you don't achieve it in certain time, you'll be feeling hopeless. And we don't want to do that. We said in Muslims community that our duty, religious or moral obligation, is to struggle. Now the victory has to have many reasons to be provided. One reason, that struggle has to be there, which is our part, and we're doing that. We're going to continue doing that. Now, there are other elements has to be from here. You are in an area, international community, regional conflict, and all that. How much influence it have, I don't know. I'm not sure. But the main influence, the main factor is the struggle of the people, and we're going to continue our struggle.
Nabeel, thank you for joining us. And thank you to all of you at home. We'll see you next time on another episode of Face to Face.